Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. On today's program, you will hear Brian Lynn report on a way South Africa is providing medical care. Ashley reports on student mobile phone restrictions in California. Learn about appositives on everyday grammar, and then the lesson of the day. But first...
In South Africa, a former passenger train now serves as a traveling medical center to provide health services to people in need. The train is known as Pelo Pepa. In the Sesotho language, this means good, clean health. It travels across South Africa to provide medical care to a mix of patients for whom usual health care is unavailable or rare. The train has been operating since South Africa's government ended its racist system of apartheid in the early 1990s. The train carries medical professionals around the country, even to the most rural villages. Officials say the service helps at least 375,000 South Africans each year. The care patients receive is separate from the government's main public health care system. That system serves an estimated 84% of the population. But government insurance plans are too costly for many people to pay for. South Africa is also dealing with an unemployment rate of more than 32%. The government has taken some steps to help get more of the nation's population covered by public health insurance plans. One of those came in May when South African President Cyril Ramaphosa signed a law creating the country's National Health Insurance Act. The law aims to provide financial assistance to millions of South Africans who do not currently have health insurance. The program gets support from private insurers. However, the National Health Insurance Act has been hotly debated. Critics have said government officials have not yet said how much the program will cost or where that money will come from. Economists have predicted the government will have to raise taxes to finance the law. Critics have urged the government to instead fix the country's public health care system. Tetiwe Malangu has used the health train and recently spoke to the Associated Press about her experiences. She said local health clinics in her area in the township of Tembisa, east of Johannesburg, cannot effectively serve her needs. "There we were not treated well," Malangu said. "We are made to sit in the sun for long periods. You can sit there from 7 a.m. until around 4 p.m. when the clinic closes." She noted that when people ask about such issues, the medical workers say they simply need bigger hospitals. When the train began in 1994, many black people in South Africa still lived in rural villages with little availability to health centers. The time was a period of great change in South Africa. Today, the trains assist the growing populations of the capital, Pretoria, as well as Johannesburg, the country's economic center. Shimona Kendia is the train's manager. She told the AP trains can remain in one place for multiple days to see as many people as possible. Those going to major population centers, like Tembisa, for example, can end up staying up to 2 weeks. The major metros are really struggling, Kendia said. Malangu's trip resulted in her getting a new pair of glasses. She was among hundreds of people who received health services from the train on its latest stop. Another patient, Jane Mabuza, got a full health examination as well as services for her teeth. She said she hopes the train will be able to reach many more people in other areas. Here on the train, you never hear that anything has been finished, Mabuza added. I'm Brian Lynn.
A new state law will soon require school districts in California to create new rules restricting student smartphone use. California Governor Gavin Newsom signed the law recently. The legislation makes California the latest state to try to reduce student phone access. Florida, Louisiana, Indiana, and several other states have also passed laws aimed at restricting student phone use at school. The legislation is aimed at reducing distractions in the classroom. It is also meant to address the mental health effects that social media can have on children. Newsom said in a statement, "This new law will help students focus on academics, social development, and the world in front of them, not their screens, when they're in school." But some critics of such policies worry the rules will make it harder for students to seek help if there is an emergency. Critics also argue that decisions on phone bans should be made by school districts and not state governments. The law requires districts to pass rules by July 1, 2026. The rules should limit or ban students from using smartphones on school grounds or while students are under the supervision of school employees. The new law comes after Newsom signed an earlier law in 2019 permitting school districts to restrict student phone access. In June, Newsom announced plans to seek more legislation. His announcement came after the U.S. Surgeon General called on the United States Congress to require written warnings on social media platforms describing their effects on young people. Newsom sent letters to school districts in August urging them to limit student device use in school. Assemblymember Josh Hoover represents the city of Folsom. Hoover introduced the bill with a group of lawmakers. Phones are restricted where Hoover's children attend school. He said many of the students do not always like the policy. He said that is in part a sign of how addictive phones can be. Hoover said, "Anytime you're talking about interrupting that addiction, it's certainly going to be hard for students sometimes." Some parents have raised concerns that school cell phone bans could cut parents off from their children if there is an emergency, such as a school shooting. The 2019 law permitting districts to restrict student phone access makes exceptions for emergencies. The new law does not change that. Some supporters of school phone restrictions say it may be safer to have phones off in an active shooter situation. Shakinya Edison is assistant superintendent with the Santa Barbara Unified School District. The district put in place a ban on student phone use in class during the 2023 to 2024 school year. She said teachers have noted that their students are paying closer attention in class since the start of the ban. Tarek McFall is principal of Sutter Middle School in Folsom. He said that before his school's cell phone ban, students recorded fights, filmed TikTok videos, and spent lunchtime looking at their phones. The ban has totally changed the culture of the school, he said. Now, students spend more time talking to one another. To have them put away, to have them power off, it has been a great thing, McFall said. I'm Ashley Thompson.
Imagine you want to improve your writing skills. Perhaps you would like to take an English test or use English in a business email. Today on Everyday Grammar, we will talk about something that could help you, appositives. We will explain the grammar rules behind appositives and demonstrate how to use them in sentences. Let us begin with a few definitions.
An appositive is a word or group of words that renames something else. An appositive is often a noun or noun phrase that helps explain or identify another noun or a pronoun. Take this sentence, for example.
My best friend, Ahmed, studies English literature.
The subject of the sentence is my best friend. The name, Ahmed, is an appositive. It adds information to the sentence. What is important is that the sentence is grammatically correct without the appositive. So, our example without the appositive would read,
my best friend studies English literature.
Now, let us consider a more complex example. Imagine you are reading a crime novel. Perhaps the book has the following lines.
Police questioned the next suspect, the victim's ex-wife.
In this example, the victim's ex-wife is the appositive. The words give readers more information about the next suspect. If the sentence did not have an appositive, it would have been written this way. Police questioned the next suspect.
Martha Kolln and Robert Funk wrote a famous book on English grammar. In it, they note that if an appositive renames the subject of a sentence, it can introduce the same sentence. Kolln and Funk say the following description, by Michael D. Lemonic and Andrea Dorfman, is a good example of an introductory series of appositives. It is about epithets, or insulting terms, that people used to describe the Vikings of Northern Europe.
Ravagers, despoilers, pagans, heathens, such epithets pretty well summed up the Vikings for those who lived in the British Isles during medieval times.
The nouns ravagers, despoilers, pagans, and heathens are all epithets, the subject of the sentence. The writers could have left out the list of nouns. Instead, they could have begun the sentence simply with the words, epithets such as, or such epithets. You might be asking yourself why this discussion is important. The reason is this. Using appositives correctly is one of the best ways to improve your writing style. Appositives can help writers change the rhythm or order of a sentence. In other words, appositives help make sentences more interesting. Think back to our first example.
My best friend Ahmed studies English literature.
If you were to write the example as two separate sentences, it might be something like this.
My best friend studies English literature. My friend's name is Ahmed.
These sentences are grammatically correct, but they are repetitive. In other words, they are less interesting to read.
The next time you are reading, try to find examples of appositives. Ask yourself why the writer might have chosen to use them. When you practice writing in English, perhaps for a test or business purposes, try to use appositives in certain places. They will help make your writing smooth and clear if you use them correctly. We will leave you with a famous example. In his book, A History of the English-Speaking Peoples, Winston Churchill wrote the following words about Britain's Queen Victoria.
High devotion to her royal task, domestic virtues, evident sincerity of nature, a piercing and sometime disconcerting truthfulness, all these qualities of the Queen's had long impressed themselves upon the mind of her subjects.
Can you identify the appositive? Can you identify the subject of the sentence? Write to us in the comments section of our website. I'm Ann Ball.
And I'm John Russell.
My name is Anna Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
We talked about Lesson 22 in our recent podcast. Today, we'll take a closer look at Lesson 23. Anna and her coworkers are going out for lunch together. They work in an area where there are not many restaurants, so people come with special trucks to the area at lunchtime.
Yes, we call these food trucks. And it's a fun way to explore different foods from all over the world. Washington, D.C. is an international city, so you can find foods from many cultures there. Since Anna came from a small town, she is not familiar with the food trucks in this lesson.
Washington, D.C. has great food from all over the world. Today, I'm having lunch with my boss. Ms. Weaver says we're going on a trip around the world, but she knows I only have an hour for lunch. Silly woman.
Hi, Anna.
Hi, Jonathan. Hey, we are meeting Ms. Weaver for lunch at noon, aren't we?
Yes.
What time is it now?
11:50.
11:50? We have to go. So, where is this world food restaurant?
We are not eating at a restaurant.
Where are we eating?
We are eating at food trucks.
I remember my first experience with food trucks. I was impressed that I could get Mexican food in a park. In other parts of the world, you might hear the term street food when people talk about buying food from a vendor, a seller, that is, who sets up a small table on the sidewalk or side of the street and cooks simple, delicious dishes for the people who are walking by.
Back to our story. Ms. Weaver wants to treat Anna and Jonathan to lunch. That means she is paying for the food. So she gives them each some money and tells them to find something to buy from one of the trucks. And of course, Anna thinks it's an awesome idea.
Food trucks? Awesome! What's a food truck?
These are food trucks.
Wow! Whoa.
Okay, Jonathan, you will buy the first dish. Here is $10. Surprise us.
Okay. I'll be back in 15 minutes.
What country do I want to visit?
Anna, you pick the second country. Here is $10.
I want chicken.
The food truck over there has great chicken.
Awesome!
After you buy your food, meet me here.
Do you enjoy eating at food trucks, Jill?
I used to when we worked downtown every day. Especially they had pho, the Vietnamese soup. It was so good. But now they don't come near the office. There are some near the museums, but they mostly sell ice cream and American food like hamburgers and fries. Besides, there's no place to sit near most of the food trucks.
Huh. That reminds me of what one of my cousins said. He said that food trucks would be nicer if they had some tables and chairs and refills on drinks.
But then they'd be restaurants. The other thing I don't like about food trucks is how noisy they are. They have to run a generator, a machine to make electricity, for cooking and keeping the food warm or cold. It's already loud, and then they sometimes play loud music, too.
That's true. But you have to trade off the noise for the convenience of being able to buy your meal quickly and cheaply.
I don't know. They may be handy, but I still prefer a quiet restaurant or one with tables outside so you can enjoy nice weather. Then there's the problem of the trucks running out of food. In our lesson, both Jonathan and Anna have to change their orders because the food trucks have sold the meals they want.
Excuse me, I'll have the shrimp. Oh, you're out of shrimp? Okay, I'll have the beef then.
I want the chicken dish.
We're out of chicken.
You're out of chicken?
Yep.
I'll try another food truck. Thanks.
I noticed they said out of quickly. So it almost sounds like one word, out of. Jill, do you know any expressions with that pronunciation?
Yeah. When we leave a place, like when we're going home from our place of work, we might say, I'm out of here.
Notice that Jill used the word handy to talk about something that is convenient. And another thing that's convenient is how you can buy your food from a food truck with cash, a credit card, and now maybe with your phone. Let's hear how Jonathan returns part of the money Ms. Weaver gave him.
Okay, here's your change. The dish cost $7, so here is $1, $2, $3 back from your $10.
I noticed two things there. He says, here's your change, which means the money not needed for the cost of the food. And then he counts out the bills as he hands them to Ms. Weaver.
I think all of our listeners understand how we talk about our dollar bills, our paper money. But maybe it would be good to review what U.S. coins are.
Sure. There are four coins in regular use nowadays. Those are the penny, which is 1 cent, the nickel, 5 cents, and the quarter, which is 25 cents. People sometimes run into a half dollar, which is 50 cents, or a dollar coin, which is a dollar or 100 cents.
Jill, whose picture is on each coin?
Well, I'm not sure. Let me try. A penny is Abraham Lincoln, of course. On the nickel, it's Thomas Jefferson. Who's on the quarter now? Aren't there different ones for each state these days?
The backs of those coins are different now. There is one for each state. But the front is still our first president, George Washington. And here's a fun fact. In 2022, they made him face the opposite direction. He had always been facing to the left, but now he's facing to the right.
I'm not sure about the political meaning of that, but here's another fun fact about U.S. coins. One of my distant cousins was a model for the Walking Liberty half dollar. She was a neighbor of the artist.
That's a cool family story. Speaking of who is on the coins, we left out a very important historic figure. Do you remember who is on the dollar coin?
Since 2000, it's been Sacagawea, a Native American woman who guided Lewis and Clark across the West to the Pacific Ocean. I love those coins because they look like gold. At a family camp I used to go to, one of the men would always give the children a dollar coin to use for ice cream on the 4th of July.
Speaking of ice cream, in our lesson, it's time for dessert, something sweet to eat. Listen carefully to how Ms. Weaver asks Anna what she wants to do with the remaining money.
Well, we still have $8. What do you want now?
We can buy dessert.
I'll buy dessert.
In Washington, D.C., you can travel around the world with food trucks, and it does not cost a lot.
Ms. Weaver said, "What do you want?" instead of, "What do you want?" Isn't that pretty informal?
Yes, but remember, they are eating lunch on the street. It's a pretty informal situation.
Hey, Andrew, can we do another chant with what we learned today?
Sure. Yeah, let's do that. And listeners, you can practice some of the things we talked about today by repeating after us.
Food trucks, handy, noisy food trucks.
Get some lunch, get a snack, and then you will be right back.
What do you want?
I'll have fish.
Sorry, we're out of that. What do you want?
I'll have chicken.
Sorry, we're out of that. What do you want?
Okay, then I'll have shrimp.
You got it.
Food trucks. Travel the world with food trucks. Pay with cash or card.
You can even pay by phone, and it doesn't cost a lot. Now we have an assignment for you. We'd like to know your answer to our questions. Does your town have a special street food? How do you like to eat it? You can send your answer in an email to us on learningenglish@voanews.com. Or, if you're watching this podcast on YouTube, put your answer in the comments. We'll read some of your answers in an upcoming podcast.
That's all for the lesson of the day today. You can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins. Now I'm going to stop and get some ice cream at that food truck on the corner.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.